Let us now take a look at a different scheme of feedback, which I mentioned earlier, but we have not gone into it, namely integral feedback. What we had been looking at was proportional feedback. Now, the first time one looks at integral feedback, it looks rather mysterious and difficult to figure out exactly how it works. But we will look at it first from the point of view of the transfer functions involved and then try to understand it from a more dynamic point of view. So, we have our old block diagram in which I had shown omega s as related to two inputs, Ea of s, the applied voltage input, and the load torque input through two transfer functions. So, let me redraw the diagram. Here is TL of s, and that goes through a block whose gain I had called GT of s, T for torque. Then there is Ea of s, the applied voltage, and that goes through a block which I had called GA of s. And these two are added together, one with a plus sign, the other with a minus sign, to produce omega s, the Laplace transform of the angular speed or velocity of the motor. So, in other words, this block diagram represents only the equation omega s equal to Ea into GA, that is the transfer function GA multiplies the applied voltage Ea minus the transfer function GT multiplies the load torque TL. We have of course had a look at the expressions for these two transfer functions GA and GT earlier. We will need them a little later as we go on. Now, in the open loop control situation, or that is in the situation of control where no feedback is used, you remember that what we do is we just apply a constant voltage to the input of the system, that is at the armature, whether or not the load torque changes, whether or not the speed changes, we just apply a constant input voltage. This means we are not going to look at what the output is doing, whether the output speed is at the correct value or is it any different. We just apply a pre-calculated voltage at the input, and under normal conditions, rated torque, parameter values being exact, etcetera, we expect that the output will be at the expected value, at the rated value. And that is what we are referred to as the open loop. Of course, there is no loop yet, so it is not a question of opening a loop. I had also called it pre-programmed or pre-calculated input or pre-calculated control action. I want a certain output speed under certain conditions. What should be the input voltage? I calculate that and try to maintain it at that value. As I told you, of course, no control system is operated exactly like this. There is always at least a human operator, a supervisor of some kind, who will look at what is happening and who will usually be have some means at his disposal for making some adjustment. In this case, the adjustment would be that of the armature voltage. And so, probably if you are using it in this fashion, then there will be a provision for adjusting the armature voltage, and there will be an operator who will be looking at the speed and seeing whether it is the same as the desired value or not. Then we saw that we can change this scheme of things by providing for an automatic adjustment of the applied voltage, and that was the Leonard system of control, in which the speed is measured, or a voltage proportional to the speed is obtained through a tacho generator. There is a reference voltage. The difference between the two is then amplified and fed to the armature of the motor. The reference voltage, of course, is kept fixed. It is kept fixed at a pre-calculated value depending on what speed you want under rated conditions. And I told you that contrary to what many textbooks say, such a system will work with zero steady state error. That is, if the disturbance is or the load torque is at the rated value, the parameter values are exactly what they were assumed to be, then one can calculate a reference voltage such that the motor will run at the desired speed. Although, if when you compare the reference voltage with the tacho generator output voltage, the two will not be equal. There will be a small difference between the two, and this difference amplified by the amplifier produces the armature voltage. But this difference is not the error. It is a difference between the reference voltage and the feedback voltage, but this the difference does not represent any error. It provides you with the required voltage or required output, which when amplified will generate the required applied voltage, voltage to be applied to the armature. So there is no steady state error. However, with that system which we had just studied, if the load torque changes, then the speed is not going to remain constant, because we are keeping the reference voltage constant. The speed is not going to remain constant. However, the scheme is such that the change in speed, because of change in torque, that is because of disturbance signal, will be less than what it was in the pre-programmed case. And we saw how we can figure that out with the help of the Mason gain formula applied to the block diagram. We will do the same thing now to our system. What we will now put is what is called an integrator in the forward path. Now, what is an integrator? Now, an integrator, some of you have already perhaps in your electronic circuits, analog circuits, encountered integrator circuits. For example, an operational amplifier can be configured suitably to produce this action of integration. So, if I show it as a block, what will be the transfer function of an integrator? The transfer function of an integrator is 1 divided by S. Now, this follows because of another theorem of the Laplace transformation, that is, if I have a function f of t and its Laplace transform is f of s, capital F of s. Now, I define another function g of t, which is an integral of this function f, let us say starting from 0 up to a running time t, and therefore, I will have to write this as f tau d tau. So, from the signal f through this action of integration with lower limit 0, upper limit is the running time t, I obtain another signal g of t. Then the Laplace transform of this g of t, which is g of s, is related to f of s by the simple relation g of s is 1 by s times f of s. So, if I look at the integrator, its output is g t, its input is f t, output transform is g of s, input transform is f of s, and therefore, the transfer function of the integrator. What was the definition of the transfer function of the transfer function of a system? It is a ratio of the Laplace transform of the output to the Laplace transform of the input if the initial conditions are 0, or alternately, it is the Laplace transform of an appropriate part of the output divided by the Laplace transform of the input. And the concept transfer function is useful only when this ratio of the two transforms does not depend on the input. In this case of the integrator, the ratio of the two transforms Gs over Fs is simply 1 by S, and so it does not depend on what Ft is. Now, of course, graphically we can imagine what the output of the integrator will be if we know the input to the integrator. So, let me draw the block diagram once again, and I will put the integral symbol here 0 to t. The transfer function is 1 by S. Suppose to that I give a constant input starting from time t equal to 0, let us say its value is 1. So, this is the constant function 1, which is the input to the integrator. Then what will be the output of the integrator? The output of the integrator will be integral 0 to t of 1 d tau, and therefore, it will be a unit ramp function. It will be a function whose graph will be a straight line passing through the origin, and it's the formula for it will be simply t at time t. If instead of a constant function 1, I apply a constant function of some other value, let us say I apply a constant function 2, then the output of the integrator will be 2 t. Remember that the integration is from 0 to t. If we do not integrate from 0 to t, then we may get an additional constant, an additive constant as a part of the output. So, that is why I said that we are going to look at only a part of the output and its transform rather than the entire output in the general situation. So, this is the integrator its transfer function is 1 by s. The point is that if I have a constant input to the integrator, then the output of the integrator goes on increasing. It will increase without limit. Of course, in practice, you cannot have a physical system whose output, some variable, can simply go on increasing. And you know that when you use an operational amplifier in an integrator circuit, you never apply a constant voltage to the input of the integrator, because if you did, what happens to the operational amplifier circuit? The output gets saturated. So, the output never goes on increasing beyond a certain limit, which is set by the supply voltage. So, a practical integrator, if you give it a constant input, will never produce an ideal ramp which simply goes on increasing. But suppose now to the integrator, you do not apply a constant voltage, but you apply some other waveform of voltage. For example, you may apply an exponential input. So, let us say to the integrator, I apply the input e to the minus t. It is an exponential function. So, here is the integrator, integral 0 to t, and to it I apply e raised to minus t. The input signal will go on decreasing as time increases. The time constant in this case will be 1. So, after t equal to 10, the signal is virtually 0, the input is virtually 0. But what about the output? What will be the output of the integrator when the input to it is e to the minus t? Now, one way of finding out will be to use the Laplace transformation. Let us do that. What is the Laplace transform of e to the minus t? It is 1 divided by s plus 1. This is the Laplace transform of the input. What is the transfer function of the integrator? It is 1 divided by s. So, what is the Laplace transform of the output? 1 upon s multiplied by 1 upon s plus 1. Now, in this case, the partial fraction expansion is very simple. So, it is simply 1 by s minus 1 by s plus 1, as you can verify. This s plus 1 goes here, s goes here, difference is 1 divided by s into s plus 1. So, this is the partial fraction expansion of the output transform. And now, it is very easy to invert this. If I invert this, what do I get? 1 by s gives me 1, and 1 by s plus 1 gives me e raised to minus t. So, the output will be 1 minus e raised to minus t. So, what will be the output waveform? Now, this is a waveform which should be familiar to all control people, and we have already had a look at such a waveform. It is what is sometimes called a signal which rises exponentially to a steady value. It is not the signal e raised to t which keeps on growing without any limit. It is a signal which rises to a steady value, and the waveform of it or the graph of it will be something like this. So, to an integrator, if I give an input which is the exponentially decaying function, so that the input eventually becomes 0 after some time, the output, however, does not become 0. The output approaches the limiting value 1. And so, after the same amount of time that has elapsed, which makes the input virtually 0, the output of the integrator is not 0, but it remains constant. Now, this is the special property of the integrator, and it is not really puzzling if you are looking at the process of integration, because you have in the calculus courses looked at the operation of integration. Integration is area under the curve. So, if you look at it that way, then one can see why, when the input goes to 0, the output does not go to 0, but the output approaches a constant value in the limit. This is because the integral is the area under the curve, and as time increases, I get more and more area under the curve. So, the output will go on increasing. However, and that is not clear from the graph, the area under the exponential curve is finite. It does not keep on growing. It keeps on approaching the value 1. So, looking at integration as the operation of area under a graph or under the curve that represents a given function, we can see that even when the input approaches 0, the output may not and will not very often approach 0, but even it may approach a constant value, which means that eventually, after say time 10 time constants in this case, the input is 0, but the output is non-zero. That is, from an input which appears to be 0, when you look at it after a certain time, the output has arisen which is not 0. And this is something which may appear to be a little mysterious, that even when the input has become 0, the output of the system has not become 0, but in fact it has approached a constant value. But remember, the input was not 0 all the time, if to an integrator, and so this is of course very trivial, but let us look at it once again. If to the integrator I give the 0 function as the input, then what will be the output? The area under the 0 curve is 0, so the output will be 0. So, if you give an input which is all the time 0, then the integrator output will not be non-zero, but in fact will be 0. But if to the integrator you give an input which has been non-zero for some time and then becomes 0 or very close to 0, its output need not be close to 0 at all. Of course, depending on the input waveform, the output may not build up to a steady value like 1. For example, if I apply a sinusoidal input to an integrator, what will be the nature of the output? Now, remember your calculus course, if the derivative of sine is cosine, then the integral of cosine is sine. So, if I have an oscillating input given to an integrator, the output of the integrator will also be oscillating, although in addition it may have a DC component depending on when you start the integration process. Or in the operational amplifier integrator, if the capacitor which is put across the feedback link, if it is initially charged, then there will be a DC shift. And so, the output will not be just sinusoidal, but will be sinusoidal with a DC shift. If the input is not sinusoidal, but goes through maybe positive and negative variation, then the output will not approach a constant value. It may go through variations also, depending on how much of positive and negative variation was there in the original signal. The output signal may finally be positive or negative or may even go to 0. To take just a very simple example, suppose I take an input which has this form, that is, it is constant for some time, then it is negative, constant for an equal amount of time, and then it stays 0. So, it is a square pulse, symmetrical square wave, but only one pulse applied. What will be the output of this integrator? Now, you perhaps have done experiments of this kind, applying a single pulse or applying a pulse repeatedly after sufficient time delay, what does the output waveform look like and so on. So, in this case, if I apply a square, single square pulse, symmetrical square pulse to the integrator input, what will be the output? Well, the input is constant for a certain part of the time, so the output goes on increasing, but then the input suddenly becomes negative and remains constant for another interval of time, so the output goes on decreasing. Thereafter, the input remains 0, so the output now being 0 already remains 0. So, if the input is a square pulse, the output is a triangular pulse. So, the operation of integration can do interesting things of this kind, and therefore, it is used in electronic circuits, as you are perhaps aware. We can use it in our control application as well. Going back to our problem, what I want is a constant voltage here at the armature terminal. I want a constant voltage at the armature terminal. Can I get it from a voltage which does not remain constant, but which can go to 0 also? Yes, the answer is I can do that if that input to the integrator has been non-zero for at least some time. If it has been non-zero for at least some time, then the integral will build up to a constant value, and therefore, even when that input becomes 0, the output of the integrator and therefore, the input to the armature can remain constant at a certain value. So, this is the idea. Now, that voltage which is to be integrated, we can think about it as obtained from the actual speed and the desired speed. That is, if there is an error between the actual speed and the desired speed, then this difference will be non-zero, and if that difference is integrated, it can result in something which is non-zero and in fact may remain constant if the difference becomes 0 after some time. One immediate conclusion from this is that if you are going to use an integrator somewhere in the system, then there will have to be a non-zero error for some time. to produce an output which is constant after that time. In other words, the system will have to have a non-zero error for some time if you want no error after that time. So, if you want the steady state error to become 0, you will have to tolerate a non-zero error, but that is all right, because in the case of the proportional feedback, in any case, when the load torque changes, we saw that the speed will change. So, the transient state also the speed changes and there is a steady state error. There is the possibility here, however, of having non-zero steady state error when load torque changes. The steady state error is produced earlier, was produced earlier by changes in load torque. Now, there is a possibility that with changes in load torque, there will not be any steady state error because of the action of the integrator. So, we will have to put this integrator block. So, where shall we put it? As I said, the constant armature voltage which we have to generate, I will put it here, so that it is the output of the integrator block. And what should be the input to the integrator block? I need something which is non-zero for some interval of time, thereafter it can very well become 0, the output will be a constant voltage at the integrator terminal. So, this signal which goes into the input of the integrator, what should it be? It can now be a difference between a reference voltage which represents the speed and the output of the TACO generator voltage. Remember, we still need to look at what the speed actually is, because we will take any corrective action or any adjustment only if the speed is not at the correct value. If the motor is running at the correct speed, there is no need to make any adjustment at all. So, it is necessary to look at the speed of the motor. Therefore, I will have to take feedback from the speed of the motor, and of course, as before, we do not measure the speed, we simply put a TACO generator whose output is a voltage proportional to the speed of the motor. We will have a reference input ER, and then we will have, as before, the difference device or the comparator ER with one input and the TACO generator output as the other input. The only thing, the difference between this scheme and the previous scheme is the following. Previously, when we did not have the integrator block, but we simply had an amplifier here, the reference voltage was such that the output of the TACO generator corresponding to the rated speed of the motor was not the reference voltage equal to the reference voltage. The reference voltage had to be slightly greater than the TACO generator output voltage corresponding to the rated speed. If you remember, we said that okay, the TACO generator output was 20 volts, then the reference voltage may have to be 21 volt, so that there is a difference of 21 minus 20 equal to 1, that when amplified produces say 230 volts at the armature terminal. If the reference voltage was made exactly equal to the TACO generator output at rated speed, then the difference device will have voltage 0 under rated conditions, and then therefore, there will be no armature voltage. So, you cannot have the motor running on 0 volts. Now, of course, this unfortunately was misunderstood, has been misunderstood as steady state error, but that is not so. The reference voltage with proportional feedback had to be slightly greater by an appropriate amount than the feedback voltage produced under rated conditions. For rated speed, whatever is the TACO generator voltage output, the reference voltage has to be more larger than it by an appropriate, by a suitable amount. It is the difference which is amplified, and we saw last time that because of this action, the effect of the change in the load torque on the speed is reduced. Remember what was the factor that was involved? It was the loop gain L, and the loop gain L in that case depended on, of course, the transfer function GA, the TACO generator coefficient KTG, and in place of the integrator, I had only a simple gain KA, and L can be made large by having the gain large, and therefore, the effect of the disturbance could be reduced to any extent you wanted by increasing the gain of the amplifier in the forward path, or in effect increasing the loop gain. But I said that that is not desirable, as we will find out very soon. We cannot increase the loop gain without to any level that we like because of transient performance, its effect on transient performance. Now, that again is something we have to be careful about, but at the moment we are only worried about steady state operation. All right then. So, continuing with the old calculations, if the tachogenerator output voltage under rated speed conditions is 20 volts, then the reference voltage will be exactly 20 volts now. So, ER is 20 volts, the tachogenerator output under rated conditions is 20 volts. So, if the motor is running at the desired speed, the reference voltage is 20, tachogenerator output is 20, the difference is 0. Therefore, is the armature voltage 0? No, the armature voltage is not 0 because you had the integrator in between. So, if this difference had been non-zero, then because of the integration action, it could build up to a level such that the armature voltage is at the correct value. Now, can the difference be non-zero? Well, the answer is yes, because if I start the motor from 0 speed condition, then at t equal to 0, the output quantity of the speed is 0, tachogenerator output voltage is 0, the reference voltage of course is not 0. So, the output of the difference device is not 0, but it is actually a positive quantity, and the integrator starts integrating this function. Therefore, the integrator output will start building up. Now, it is interesting and fortunate that the output of the integrator will build up, keep on building up to exactly the required value, so that the input to the integrator eventually becomes 0. Now, this, as I said, sounds a little mysterious, but that is the way the integrator works. If you assume that the integrator faithfully integrates the input, then this is something that will happen, as we will see. So, although if the motor is started from rest, therefore, of course, there is speed error right away. The motor should be running at full speed, but it is at 0 speed. Well, you have to give it some time to speed up. As the motor speeds up, the output of the comparator goes on decreasing, but the output is not 0. The output is positive at t equal to 0, it goes on decreasing, but unless the speed has increased to a value larger than the rated speed, the output here will be positive. The integrator goes on integrating it, and therefore, the integrator output goes on building up. As the integrator output builds up, the armature voltage is increased, so the motor speeds up. And as we will see, all this will come to an end, so to speak, after enough number of time constants have elapsed, when the motor will run at the desired speed, the tachogenerator output will be equal to the reference signal, the output of the difference device will be 0, but the output of the integrator will not be 0, but will be exactly the required armature voltage, which produces the desired speed. Now, what about change in torque? What is going to happen when the load torque changes? We will find out exact expressions for the steady state value under change torque as we did earlier, but before we do that, let us look at it from again the qualitative point of view. So, suppose the motor is running at the desired speed now, because the load torque was at the rated value and we had done pre-calculations in such a way that the motor did run at the desired speed. Now, we will see that for that we may have to make some adjustments somewhere, but let us come to that only later. Now, suppose the load torque suddenly increases. Maybe the mechanical job that is working encounters more resistance, the metal, there is some hard part of it or whatever. So, the load torque suddenly increases. Then what is going to happen? Now, the way I am going to talk about it, it will be as if there is a sequence that this happens first, then this happens, then this is followed by that, and so on. When we model the system, when you write it in the form of a differential equation, the differential equation does not show you anything like that. The differential equation simply says the derivatives are related to the function in such and such a way. So, when I look at the differential equation, I will not be able to say that as this happens, then this will happen, then this will happen, and so on. So, remember this, that this is only an approximate way of understanding what is going to happen. What is going to happen, if our models are good, will then be determined by whatever transfer functions or differential equations that we write. So, first qualitatively, what will happen? I increase the load torque suddenly. the effect of increasing the load torque is, if the armature current of the motor had remained the same, so the motor torque remained the same, load torque has increased, therefore there will be a deceleration of the motor. Of course, the motor does not decelerate instantaneously because it has a moment of inertia. So, the motor speed will start falling below the rated value. Therefore, the tachogenerator output voltage will be less than ER. As a result, the output of the difference device, which was 0 till then, will become positive. Now, the integrator starts integrating it. The integrator output is not 0, the integrator output is already at the exact level, say 230 volts. Now, we have a non-zero input applied to the integrator when its initial value was not 0, but was 230 volts. The integrator integrates the input from that moment onward. Therefore, the output of the integrator will increase to a value greater than 230 volts. In other words, the integrator output will be greater than what the voltage was earlier. The load torque has increased, but now the armature voltage has increased. Therefore, the armature current will increase. Increase in armature current will produce a greater amount of torque, and we will say that finally, things will become steady when the new voltage is such that the new torque exactly balances the load torque and the frictional torque, and the motor is back at its rated value, the motor speed is back at the rated value. On the other hand, suppose the load torque decreases. Assuming that the armature current does not decrease immediately and or does not change immediately. And why is that so? Because the armature circuit has inductance, it has also its electrical inertia. So, the armature current will not change instantaneously even if the torque is suddenly reduced. So, the armature current has not changed instantaneously, the motor torque has not changed, the load torque has decreased, therefore, the motor will start accelerating. The speed will increase, start increasing beyond the rated value. The tachogenerator voltage will become greater than the reference voltage. The output of the integrator now will become negative. The integrator already was at 230 volts. Now, the input is no longer 0, but it is some negative quantity. So, to this 230 will be added the integral of the input. So, the output of the integrator will start decreasing from 230 volts. When the output of the integrator decreases or the applied voltage decreases, the back EMF has reduced a little bit, but not much. The difference which produces the armature current is decreasing. So, the armature current will start decreasing. Finally, we will say that the whole thing will come to an end when the speed is at the same value as before, the error output of the difference device has become 0, therefore. But the output of the integrator is no longer 230 volts, but it is now perhaps 220 volts, which is enough to make the motor run at the rated speed because the load torque has reduced. So, qualitatively it seems that there is a possibility that with this kind of a feedback arrangement, and remember that we have not only the integrator here, but we also have some kind of a proportional device here. Because I need to measure the speed of the motor anyway. I can take the action will be automatic provided the speed is being measured, and so this is necessary. Somehow the arrangement is such when the load torque changes, the speed will change for a short period of time, but it will eventually return to the desired value. And therefore, in this sense, there will be no steady state error in speed or the output quantity, even when there is a permanent change in the disturbance signal, in this case the load torque. So, this is true zero steady state error situation. Now, to understand this in terms of transfer functions, let us look at it once again from the point of view of the transfer function idea. We have a block diagram already, we have two inputs. One of the input now, instead of EA of S, I am showing it still here, but we are not interested in it. The reference signal is the input, and the reference signal once again is going to be kept constant. So, I have omega S, which is affected by ER of S and TL of S. So, I will have an expression for omega s, which as before will have one transmittance multiplying E r of s minus another transmittance multiplying T l of s. And to find the transmittances, one has to once again apply the Mason gain formula. So, we will have to look at the block diagram, or you can think of the corresponding signal flow graph, and we have to find out the delta of the signal flow graph. Now, what is the delta here? There is only one loop. So, I can write down an expression for the loop gain L. The loop gain L will be, what is the loop starting here, say 1 by s, then g a through the plus to omega, then through k t g through the minus back to 1 by s. So, the loop gain L will be 1 by s multiplied by g a multiplied by k taco generator multiplied by this minus 1 through the difference device, and therefore, it will be minus g a k t g divided by s. Earlier, we did not have s, but in its place we had k a. Now, I am going to put that k a here for a more reason that you will see right away little later. So, the integrator out transfer function, instead of being 1 by s, I will put a scale factor k a by s. So, then I will have k a here and L is this. So, because this is L, what is delta? Delta is 1 minus L. Therefore, it is 1 plus g a k taco generator k a divided by s. This is my delta. Now, I have to look at the transmittances. Let us first look at the effect of the load torque, because that is the disturbance signal which is really the cause of all this modification. So, I have to look at the forward path from the load torque to omega s. Well, there is no change in it. The forward path simply goes through g t with a minus sign, because there is a minus sign that we have here. So, the gain of the forward path is minus g t, that is multiplied by delta, or what remains of delta when I consider only loops which do not touch the forward path. However, as you can see, this is the loop and this is the forward path, and therefore, the two touch each other. And therefore, the numerator delta will be simply 1, and therefore, I will have minus g t multiplied by 1, let me write that explicitly, divided by 1 plus g a k taco generator k a divided by s. This is the transmittance, and therefore, the part of omega that depends on T L, and so I am putting this vertical line here to remind us that it is not really the entire omega, but only a part of it that is affected by T L of s, then it is given by this formula. The difference now is I have this term s in the denominator here. Earlier, I did not have the s term, the s factor here, and that is going to make a big difference as we will see. Now, I want to find out the steady state part of this, or the steady state value of this. So, by the final value theorem, I multiply this by s and take the limit as s tends to 0. Therefore, I have to multiply this whole thing by s and take the limit as s tends to 0. So, let me do that. So, I have s into minus g t divided by 1 plus g a k taco generator k a divided by s into T L of s. Now, as we did earlier, I will combine this factor s with T L of s, and I will therefore rewrite this as this is equal to, I will put the minus sign out there, s into T L of s multiplied by this bracketed expression. And I will now simplify the bracketed expression by getting rid of this s in the denominator. So, I multiply both the numerator and denominator by s. Therefore, I will have minus s g t divided by s plus g a k taco generator k a. And now, I have to take the limit of this as s tends to 0 of this product. The limit of this as s tends to 0 is what? It is the new value of the torque. The torque has changed, it has therefore assumed a new value. The limit of this as s tends to 0 by the final value theorem is the steady value of the torque. So, that is the new value of the torque. What is the limit of this as s tends to 0? In the denominator, I have s plus something. So, this s goes to 0. So, this remains, but in the numerator, I have s, and as s goes to 0, this goes to 0. and therefore the limit of this whole thing is 0. So the steady value of the load torque makes no contribution to this part of the speed, and this is why the speed in the steady state in the long run, after you wait for enough number of time constants, will not change, or the change in speed because of change in load torque will be 0. This S factor which you have introduced, its appearance here in the denominator, when you multiply through its appearance in the numerator, and therefore the numerator becoming 0, whereas the denominator does not become 0, and so the ratio becomes 0. This is the crucial thing. This is the thing that is making the system work in such a way that with load torque change to a new constant value, the speed as t tends to infinity will go back to the old value, that is to the rated value, and therefore there will be no steady state error. We can look at the part of the speed that depends on the input reference voltage. So that part of the speed is given by omega s, and so I am putting a line, vertical line here to remind us of that part of the speed. Let us look at the block diagram once again. What is the forward path now? I want the forward path from ER to the omega. So through the plus sign KA by S followed by GA through plus sign again. So the gain of the forward path is KA by S into GA. Now what about delta for this particular path? Well, it touches the loop. So the delta for that is 1 divided by the same delta that we had earlier for the other transmittance, namely 1 plus GA K taco generator KA divided by S. This whole thing multiplies ER of S, right. So this is the part of the speed that depends on the reference voltage. We already looked at the part of the speed that depends on the torque. Now I want to find out the steady value of this. So I will multiply both sides by S. So S into omega S, therefore on the right hand side I will have S into that. Once again I will rewrite this as S into ER of S multiplied by this bracketed expression. Now take the limit of both sides as S tends to 0. On the left hand side I will get the steady state value of the speed. On the right hand side I will get the steady state value of the applied or the reference voltage, and that of course I have not changed, so it is as before. What about this bracketed expression? If this bracketed expression went to 0 as the S tends to 0, then the whole thing will be hopeless because the speed will be 0. Fortunately for us, as you will see, this bracketed expression will tend to a certain non-zero value, and you can find out what that non-zero value is, and from that you can figure out that under the new steady state conditions, even when the load torque has changed, the steady state speed will be equal to the reference voltage multiplied by that constant. Do this homework and we will get back to this.